Hey guys, here we go again. Hope you're hanging in there. Good job on that depression exam, most of you. So here's the next unit, World War II, 1939 to 1945. I'm going to just pan down. I think it'd be best if you just pause it. And I think it'd be good if you just write it by hand. If you want to type it up, that's fine. But write it by hand and then submit it. Take a picture of your notes or type it up and submit it through a document, whatever you want to do, just make sure, as long as I get it. It'll be due next Monday. The stuff on the red on the right, don't worry about it. I know it's hard to read. You're not supposed to really even read it. It's just some notes. So I make sure I hit the key parts. The Allies and the Axis powers I put up there just to make it a little easier. So we'll talk about those in a second. Now they're a little hard to see. Yeah, there we go. Okay. If you don't put information in the times twos and threes and sixes and everything, the most you can get is an 80. That seems fair. Some of you did that last time. I think I gave you 80s, 85s. If you want 100 or 95 and above, you've got to write the notes in between, okay? There's going to be like 20 notes. Most of the notes is in between the 20 notes, though, so make sure you get those. All right, here we go. World War. There we go. World War II. Well, box buster. There we go. Jazzy's out with the kids getting some exercise, so I'm going to try to do this on my own. Okay, so World War II, 1939 to 1945, also known as World War I Part II. The famous quote from General Foch is that during the peace treaty process, Foch actually said, you know, this is not a peace treaty, this is just an armistice that's going to last 20 years. And he said that in 1919, and sure enough, he was exactly right. 1939, Hitler invades Poland, and World War II starts. Another very interesting thing about the war is we still had a segregated army in the United States. We talked about the Harlem Hellfighters, how they had longer duration in those trenches than any other group, any other U.S. troops. And unfortunately, by 1940s, we were still segregated. So it's ironic. We're going to go fight the most racist man in the world. We've got to beat Hitler. He's such a racist. He believes his people are the master race and shall rule as of old for 1,000 years. And we went to fight the most racist man in the world with the segregated army. So both World War I and World War II were still segregated. It took Harry Truman and the 1950s with the Korean War. First time we started fighting along with each other, black guys, white guys. Okay, so who are the Allies? Almost the same size as World War I. That's another reason World War II is called World War I Part II. Got Britain and France. Usually they're together. Australia, think of Britain. Lots of Australians originated from Great Britain. Canada above us, U.S. of course, squeezing in, U.S. We didn't, at the beginning, just like World War I, we waited a year or two before we got in. India, China, very interesting about China. A lot of Americans don't know that China, in fact, China lost second most people in World War II. You've probably heard the expression, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. So who's our enemy? Japan. Who's Japan's enemy? China. So the enemy of my enemy is my friend, meaning because China was fighting against Japan and we were fighting against Japan, they're allies of ours. Soviet Union. World War I, Soviet Union got out early when we had the Russian Revolution. World War II, they got in later, and we'll talk about a little bit later, why they got in later. So the U.S. and the Soviet Union both got in later, and that's really, really important with World War II. Greece. Greece lost, I think, 1 million or so people in the war. Okay. The fascists, the Axis are called the fascists. Germany, Italy, Japan for the most part, then Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, Slovenia. Okay? Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, Slovenia, Germany, Italy, Japan. And little something about fascism. Basically, fascism is totalitarian government, meaning you have no rights, no freedoms. Basically, you go ahead and you do what the government tells you. Do what that dictator tells you to do. No freedom of speech, no freedom of press. Total control over the people. And it's usually extremely nationalistic. Any fascist country, they brainwash their kids from a very young age. It's all about the nation. It's all about the country. Japan, Italy, Germany. Hitler did it better than anybody else, making people willing to just do anything for him. So another thing about fascism, though, is usually fascism is also involved with being racist, like with Hitler. We are as a master race. We shall rule the world. Come on. Totally racist. Okay, so put some of that for the times five, okay? Fascism is totalitarian government, extreme nationalism, no freedoms, and usually there's racism involved with fascism. And as far as the countries that were neutral, Portugal, Spain, Ireland, Sweden and Switzerland. A lot of Irish people don't know that. Ireland did stay neutral on the sides. I mean, Irish and English get along a lot better now than they used to, but at one time, you know, there was terrorism in Northern Ireland and Ireland before Americans had ever heard of the word terrorism. Irish trying to get their independence from Great Britain. Great Britain not wanting to, so back and forth. They didn't have a lot of love lost between them. So Ireland was neutral, did not take England's side. Okay, what started World War II? The Treaty of World War I, which was the Treaty of Versailles. As far as spelling it, there you go. It's French, so you don't say Versailles. Remember, that's just outside of Paris. We talked about that before. And put down, it was more of a punishment treaty than a peace treaty. That's why Foch said, 20 years we'll be fighting again. Germany's going to want revenge, this treaty. But also, he said, we need to divide Germany up. And since they didn't do that, according to him, he thought, when these kids get older, these babies Germans are having, they'll be ready to fight in 20 years. So that's one of the reasons he made his prediction for 20 years. Hitler becomes Führer of Germany. Okay, so this time six is really important, okay? A lot of people don't know, but in the 1920s, part of the peace treaty, the Treaty of Versailles, Germany had to start a republic to have some type of representative government where people would be able to vote and they would make laws and have delegates representing the people. And that was called the Weimar Republic. I have it here. Here we go. It looks like a Weimar, but it's a Weimar. In German, you don't say the W sound, it's a V. So the Weimar Republic, named after the city where the Constitution was written, Weimar, Germany. Hitler slowly got more power by his Nazi party being elected. Most humans probably think Hitler just took over. I'm a dictator and that's it. No, because of the desperation and despair, that great video you guys saw in the Depression, because of desperation and despair, Hey, if your kid's not eating and you can't get the medicine for your kids and you don't have a job, democracy or dictatorship, after a while in human history, it's always about security and freedom. Hitler made the German people think that Jewish people and communists were the enemy. These we have to fight against, the communists and the Jewish. And by saying that, he got people to, the German people that were not communist or Jewish, to bond together. By having a common enemy, it's all their fault. They're to blame for your problems. You don't have a job because of them. Once you do that, you turn up the hatred, and the German people bonded together. Hey, my kid's happy. Why? Because he's got a Nazi uniform. He goes every day and does exercise. My 8-year-old's a Nazi. Little did they know, a lot of these parents, when their kids went to school, they were being told, look, if your parents say anything negative about the Führer, Adolf Hitler, come tell us. Kids were snitching on their parents. Parents getting dragged out of bed because they might have said Hitler looks ugly or Hitler's doing a terrible job. The kids were brainwashed into turning in their own parents, brainwashed into thinking Adolf Hitler was basically their god. Keep that in mind. If you can get people going like this, thinking it becomes a cult. Let's just say what it is. It becomes a cult. If you get people thinking not rationally, but only by emotion and not going by the facts, it's only about going by emotion. That's when it becomes a cult. Stalin did it in the Soviet Union, Chairman Mao did it in China, Hitler did it. When people are desperate, they'll follow. They'll follow these fascists. Chairman Mao was communist, but he still had total control over his people in China. Okay, so very important. You have to write this down for the times six also. Something called the Reichstag fire, which became the Reichstag fire decree. The Reichstag was their legislative building parliament in Germany. The Weimar Republic had a parliament, just like England has parliament. That's where the laws are made. The Reichstag was burnt to the ground. See a video of it here. Come on, hopefully we can get this going. Where are you? Here we go. Watch this, guys. Crazy stuff. Okay, so I hope you understand that Hitler was able to blame the fire of Germany's parliament building on the communist. So basically, now he's able to wipe out an entire threat to him and his power. He's able to pretty much trick the people into thinking, you need me to be in charge now. There's fear everywhere. They build that, they went ahead and burned down our parliament building. And sure enough, the president, Hindenburg, basically after that, that's why it's called the Reichstag fire decree, signed the decree giving power to Hitler to pretty much be the Führer, the leader, the dictator. Okay, so that's there. Appeasement with Hitler fails. All right, come on back over here. Appeasement with Hitler fails. Watch here, okay? Here's Britain over here. Okay, there we go. Here's Germany. Appeasement is when you give in a little bit to stop a major conflict. So write that down. Appeasement. When you give in a little bit to stop a war from happening or to stop a major conflict. So here's what happened. Hitler, this is 1930s now, 1938, I believe, yeah, 38. Hitler says, you know what? These people over here speak German. They were Germans before you screwed us up after World War I. All I want is this little area called the Sudetenland. And Lord Chamberlain over here from England, he was their leader, prime minister. First of all, he comes to Berlin. If you're going to negotiate with somebody, don't go to their home court. Don't go to their spot. He should have said, you know what, Hitler, you want to negotiate? Let's go to France. But no, Chamberlain comes all the way to Berlin. He looks at Hitler. He comes back and says, I looked that man in the eye. I trust him. All he wants is this little spot. We saved war. We're not going to have another world war. That's appeasement. When you give in to somebody a little bit because you don't want a big war, did Hitler keep his word? Of course not. I mean, it's easy to look back. Here, I think I have a, here's the famous picture. There's Chamberlain here, shaking hands with Hitler. Let's see if I get some more here. Yeah. The famous handshake. Here's the leader of England, Lord Chamberlain. Here's Hitler. Oh, sure, just take a little bit. You promise you're only going to take Sudetenland. And here's the famous. He comes back and he holds up the piece of paper and he gives the speech. We will not have World War II. We will not have another war. Adolf Hitler has promised me. He signed it. He signed it. And not long afterwards, right here, Hitler not only takes Sudetenland, he goes into Czechoslovakia and invades Poland. And that's the start of World War II, 1939, when Hitler invaded Poland. Okay, you getting it? So appeasement, just as the teacher, a good example of appeasement. I taught in a school where this young man I had from the very beginning of the school year, just totally out of control, totally disrespectful. And I was hardcore with him, you know, come on. No, you got to follow the rules. And he didn't like it, but he was trying. And then this is not on tour, by the way. This is far away. This would never happen on tour. anyway. So the administration said, look, you're too strict with him. You got to loosen up with this guy. And in other words, we used appeasement with him. In my opinion, we appeased him. And I think it was a huge mistake. Instead of giving him his boundaries, no, you can't do this, you can't do that. By the end of the year, I remember I had a guest speaker. And in the middle of my class, this guy comes rushing in, slamming the door so hard that the glass broke on my door. New York City. Anyway. So appeasement. Usually when you give in to the bad guys, the evil guys, the really megalomaniac guys, and you give in to them, they're not going to stop with that. They're not going to stop with that. So that's appeasement. So Oh, good. We've got all these now. Appeasement, you got the times three. Hitler invades Poland, put 1939. And another thing is, Hitler invades Poland, so France declares war on Germany. France has Poland's back, all right? And of course, if France is going to fight Germany, England's going to fight Germany. Boom, 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 the alliances, as we talked about in World War I. Okay, Hitler signs a non-aggression pact with the Soviet Union. Let's come back here again. Okay. So here's the Soviet Union. I'm surprised it's not in red. Okay. So Hitler, it didn't take him long to get so much of this land. We'll talk about that in a second. But Hitler said to Stalin, who's the leader of the Soviet Union, look, non-aggression pact, I won't invade you if you don't invade me. And why would Hitler do that? You probably guessed it, right? What was one of the big problems in Germany in World War I? Exactly, nice. They had to fight a two-front war. This side and this side, right? So Hitler knows two-front wars are really hard to win. So he goes to Stalin and says, look, let's just shake hands. Non-aggression pact. I won't be aggressive. I won't show aggression towards you if you don't show aggression towards me. And Stalin went with it. Okay? So that was a big deal. So put that for Hitler signs the non-aggression pact. A deal with Stalin of the Soviet Union that they would not invade each other. Okay? And that's when the Blitzkrieg starts. Germany blitzkriegs war over Europe. Blitzkrieg, think of football, the blitz, right? You linebackers out there, I bet you love to blitz. That's when you can sack the quarterback. There's a lot of war terminology in football, like in the trenches. You win football games in the trenches. That's the lineman. You're in the trenches. He's throwing a long bomb. Basically, football is you're trying to get into the other person's territory. March down the field. You know, it's very interesting. And the blitz comes from the word the blitzkrieg. The linebackers smash in as fast as they can to try to get to the quarterback. The blitzkrieg for Germany was... Blitzkrieg means lightning war. Oh, no. Come on, where is this at? Shoot. There it is. Nope. Okay, so what happened was, it was basically, let's go back to this. It was basically only Britain was left. The tanks and planes, put that for Blitzkrieg, for the times three, okay? Tanks and planes going quickly through Europe. Germany quickly, it's called lightning war. Put that also. Lightning war. Blitzkrieg translation is lightning war. Why was it so fast? Because Europe is very flat. Of course not Switzerland, but they're neutral anyway. But to get from here into France, through Belgium, into France, with tanks and airplanes, you got your planes dropping bombs, you got your tanks zipping across. That's Blitzkrieg. So it wasn't long until Britain was the only country left here. U.S. is not in it yet. Soviet Union's not in it yet. So here's the famous Churchill, the leader of... Prime Minister, Chamberlain they got rid of. You can imagine why, right? Appeasement failed with Hitler. So they put in Chamberlain, Churchill, who long ago was warning people about Hitler. So now he's their Prime Minister.
trenches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. And if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it were subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue.
What do you think, guys? New world with all its power and might. Remember World War I, Detroit, right? All those factories. They're not making cars. So the new world, America, with all its power and might, all that industrialization, that's what he's referring to.
Rescue and the liberation of the old.
Okay. Famous speech. Okay.